Dear friends, please join the presentation. I am giving the around 10 minutes presentation because the presentation is too large, but time is very short. So I'm talking now on this renewable energy technology, hybrid power generation era for sustainable growth of India. I'll be touching some prime points and then come to the technology. So far, all of you are fully aware that power system network, which is massively interconnected and very large network, is further getting added with hybrid power generation, that too renewable energy and wind energy at remote locations. The challenge I would like to put here, what in the morning session your transco person, he has mentioned just one incident. Operational complexity of this large grid with renewable energy appears to be a challenge, but there is a technological solution available if properly planned and integrated in the system within time. Therefore, what I would like to just put one point here, we all know regarding the dynamical changes in the Indian power sector, power network going on. And once I talk dynamical changes, not only the load, it's also on the renewable energy, it's also on the transmission line outages, it's also on the generation, thermal, hydro, whatever the case is. So once we say dynamical changes, it includes our stake of the energy components. Now, once I talk to system security, in the morning hours, some of the person from the IT was mentioning regarding the requirement of IT. So what I would like to address in brief, detail I had given in presentation that will be circulated, that is intelligent architecture. So once I talk to intelligent architecture, the point I would like to mention, as on date we know, we are having the SLDC, RLDC, NLDC. That structure we are fully aware. SLDCs are basically having collection from data from various thermal generations, hydro generations, load centers, clusters of load centers and so on. In the renewable energy sector, once we move towards the decentralized generation, that is the either wind cluster or solar cluster, the immediate important point is with IoT, as on date, what we have the information in real time, what are the number of units being generated by solar power plants. That is known. How randomly this generation is changing, it depends upon the environmental conditions like clouds, solar irradiance, and so on. One of the points I would like to mention, whenever we are integrating the our solar cluster into the grid structure, from distribution system, then transmission, then generation, all integrated. Now the point comes, if we don't have the intelligent architecture to ensure the local controls very effective, the repercussion may come to substation, immediate substation, maybe 11.4, maybe 33/11, maybe 400/33, the way the case is. The point here is, then I would like to put here, to ensure system security, because we are operating as one nation, one grid, one frequency. So therefore, system security and the top priority, and therefore, what is important here, what I put here, one concept, I am not talking about a smart grid as such. I'm talking the new technology, that is layered smart grid architecture. Once I say the layered smart grid architecture, it starts with the DER itself and integrates into the NLDC as one component. And therefore, what is very important to understand here is this will ensure secure and sustainable hybrid generation, because the biggest challenge is whenever there is absence of renewable energy, intermittency is introduced beyond the prediction. And as on date, there is no 100% prediction of the solar power generation or wind power generation and exactly mapping to the distribution grid or pooling to the power to the through energy exchange to the outside grid structure. I'm putting one point here just for quick understanding. Of course, you are fully aware, future grid involves the smart grid environment. Once I talk future grid, it means this grid structure is not as on date classical grid structure. This grid structure is now modified grid structure, evolving grid structure with upcoming renewable energy once we reach to 175 gigawatt and beyond. Its impact will start coming in the operation. And therefore, before we penetrate to 20, 30, 40, 60% and so on, immediate system planning, the planning wing has to take up this smart grid environment into the planning stage itself, rather than once something happens, then you start thinking of the creating the infrastructure. So in the beginning, it has to be planned and integrated with the smart grid. And I'm in touch with the CE also. Now you can look here. The renewable energy source integration, what we know so far, is involving the not only wind, solar, thermal, hydro, gas, biomass, bioenergy. The point is, what are the system requirements? So, till date, utilities have not attempted very transparently the requirements of upcoming renewable energy in the respective distribution system itself, respective sub-transmission system itself, respective larger transmission network itself. So the point I'm trying to just put it, how to look into the problem. The problem is, what should be the associated system requirements? This should be starting with the study at the earliest possible for the respective transmission, sub-transmission, distribution system as such. Now, once we talk about the integrated system operation, just you are listening in the morning, sudden cloud has reduced the generation of thousands of megawatt. Once we talk about 175 gigawatt, and further, our Honorable Power Minister has mentioned in the meeting with the, in Bigyan Bhavan recently, 200 gigawatt, added 25 gigawatt further. My point and concern is, whenever we are talking about the larger renewable penetration, whether our entire infrastructure is ready to take up, if yes, what formalities or what design issues have been considered, what are the operational issues which are going to come up, it has to address. This is, we are in the beginning, so it is better to address this issue in the beginning itself in terms of technology solutions. And therefore, what I put here, upcoming grid interface technologies are very, very important as far as R&D utilities are concerned. What I put here, components and interface devices, all of you know solar power inverters. All of you know distribution transformers. Now the solar power inverters as on date are designed only to get the power of the respective kilowatt or megawatt in the locality, either the rooftop or the solar power park. My concern is, whenever the load growth is going on either in the house or in the distribution system, whether these inverters are in a position to cater the load growth in terms of reactive power requirement. If not, they will draw the reactive power locally from the distribution system for which the distribution system has not been designed and upgraded. And therefore, this can be taken up by the utility immediately, since I have the MOU with the EMA also. So the point is, R&D division will start working parallelly how to use these solar power inverters as ancillary service itself, which will not only give the revenue to the person who is owning these inverters, but also help the local distribution system to recover within time. And therefore, what we talk, if power delivered instantly or minimum time is as good as you are ensuring the good controls. That is the power control philosophy. And therefore, what is important for that domain, this interface and components will form the backbone of the entire system structure as infrastructure. Now, coming to the grid intelligence and system security, this point I would like to quickly address. Grid intelligence is required. Why? Because we are at very remote location and we are a centralized location. We are going, the through power exchange to sell the power in the Indian grid structure. And therefore, power exchange can be further accelerated if we have the grid intelligence, and that too will involve how this grid management can be very quick, effective, and utilities are going to earn very, very, very good revenue. I would like to add one point here. That point is, what is the role of ancillary services? Adequate system studies need to be conducted starting from each distribution, sub-transmission and transmission systems, what I did mention just prior to this. Capacity of existing infrastructure needs re-evaluation, what I was talking to you, and I used to talk all the times, even CA also, with percentage of renewable energy penetration. As on date, we have thumb rule 25% only is allowed to be added as a distribution system transformers as renewable energy. How long will constraint 25%? Why not to modify the structure? How to modify the structure? That is through technology. And that just glimpse I'll give you in brief. Sectoral system planning, that is very important. And essential requirements for a sustainable power network. Once I say sectoral system planning, it means each distribution system and utilities involved must have rigorous study as on date of not only existing renewable energy and upcoming envisaged renewable energy in future also, whether their distribution system is ready, whether their consumers are going to get good quality of power by adding renewable energy or absence of renewable energy. If not, then what should the planning? I will add very, very minor and major point both. First point is, if the transformer is having 10 MVA capacity, you are adding, let us say, 5 MVA capacity, you are not permitted by the respective distribution company. But as and when we are encouraging this at 125 gigawatt further and further, whether 10 MVA, if it is crossing 10 MVA equal capacity of the distribution system in terms of the solar power, what happens? What will happen to the backside systems? If you further go another 50%, so means if you are keep on adding the renewable energy in the respective distribution system, as per the law, no one can stop you, but regulation must be there. How to ensure that power is evacuated, power is managed, consumers who are acting now, the stakeholders as the pro-consumers, are in the form of delivering the power to the grid structure and earning the revenue in the villages also. So my concern is only, at this point of time, I would like to simply convey that sectoral system planning must be in the form of transmission, sub-transmission, distribution system expansion, or putting advanced control on respective distribution system in order to ensure that power, if generated more, is restored in the system itself through the energy storage devices. It may be pumped hydro, it may be energy storage at the respective locations. And this intelligent architecture will reveal the power whenever the solar energy is out or wind energy is absent. So what is happening? You are strengthening the respective distribution system, sub-transmission system, wherever the systems you are going to install for renewable energy, in order to not only match locally requirement, but also able to ensure grid sustainability, because it is not going to have major unbalance in grid operation because you have the energy storage capacity good enough as per system planning and consumers' demand in the particular system itself. Therefore, what I put here, intelligent power controllers with IoT is the prerequisite for coordinated power exchange. So when I say IoT means, IoT starts from solar power panel, wind energy location, integrating through the substation location, then integrating to higher SLDC, RLDC, NLDC, and then entire power exchange market is going to monitor how the things are incoming or outgoing. Quickly, I'll just go this point I'm leaving. I'll come to one point. Just I would like to show for HVDC as one of the concept here. That's just simulation I'm trying to show just to understand, because the things are there. You can give the presentation to the audience. I'm giving one point to you. Let us say this is your one area, which is simply equivalent representation of the area, power injection. This also identical pattern. This is the 12 plus power HVDC power converters. Suppose we are talking about large wind energy evacuation. We have to have HVDC system only to get the faster power control. If you are having the ultra mega solar power plant, let's say 500 megawatt plus, then we must have VSC HVDC as a system integrator in between to have the least impact on the grid, because it is just like acting as a fast control and isolator also. Now the point I'm putting here, just point to understand the technology, that is, whenever we say this short circuit ratio is defined as short circuit MVA at the converter bus divided by the rated power of the DC link. And it is, if we define the effective short circuit ratio, it becomes minus QC, the filters, whatever we added at the HVDC converter station. I'm trying to simply communicate one point to you. If short circuit ratio is changing because either of the extreme load addition or sudden power loss, both are vulnerable for the entire system operation. I'm just putting glimpse remaining I have written in this presentation. I'm just showing to you, if effective short circuit ratio normally should be 3, that what we define in HVDC system. Suppose it is reducing to the lower value in either side, this is rectifier inverter. So if you don't have any control, here it is unified power flow control, nothing but STATCOM and SSC. That is an advanced power transient controllers as ancillary service. I am putting this point forward just understanding it is replicated to the distribution level also, depending upon the size of system, and this capacity can be redesigned and redefined. So the point is, the system with changing short circuit ratio is having power swing. Once I say power swing, means there is the heating of the conductor, transformer life is getting reduced. So whenever we are allowing any power swing like this, we are penalizing the assets. So there is a problem in asset infrastructure. If we are adding the controls as ancillary service here, the same system which was oscillating is now stably delivering the power to the system. So at this stage, simply I would like to communicate and conclude, because time is less. That is, one, we as a professional, we should understand existing system capacity, limitation, upgradation system planning must be there. And if we cannot change the system here, then what we should do as intelligent system controller, says that existing infrastructure is fully utilized. I will give one simple line example to you. Remaining technology I'm not going to touch. For example, 10 MVA transformer has reached the capacity, and renewable energy has added, let us say 10 MVA itself. Now 10 MVA transformer is free from secondary side loading temporarily during the period of the particular renewable energy penetration. What will happen to this 10 megawatt once it is acting as no load? This 10 megawatt power is now free, and then entire backward system has to be redefined at that given point of time in real time, that how this 10 megawatt power is now revealed in the other system where the load is going to be added or otherwise. So there is an intelligent control logic which will divert the power flow from the respective sub-transmission system, looking into all multi-district system, in order to ensure no loss to the system, no loss to the utility, but this power can be used as the storage power. Suppose you don't need the power, that power can be used as a pumped storage, energy storage, reveal the power in the system. And for that purpose, we have to study the system. We have to understand how much power is being released in the respective system, at what point of time, what is the duration of the power that is getting released, such that we can replan the system with energy storage devices suitably at different locations depending upon the availability of the entire infrastructure, which will not only create no what you call duck curve in the thermal power plant during the period of power injection to the power outage, that is the solar power or wind as such. So recommendation is, we must go for hybrid power generation, solar thermal, along with advanced controls at different layers, which will not only ensure the power availability, but also reveal the power once the renewable energy is out. Such that, so we have optimal asset management, so there is no loss to thermal generators. They are worried, all big holders of thermal power plants are worried what will happen to their business. So there is a technology solutions, and the only point is they have to come forward to join the hands and then go with the system planning and integrating entire asset management with the advanced controls. Thank you very much.